Let's pray. Father in heaven, we have prayed for your intervention. We know that your presence is here with us. Yea, we know that we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. But we know that victory is ours through Jesus Christ, because he has overcome the world. Be with us now, we pray, in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Let's take a look at Daniel chapter 9. Daniel chapter 9 and verse number 24. The Bible says, 70 weeks are determined upon thy people and upon thy holy city to finish the transgression, to make an end of sin, to make reconciliation for iniquity, and to bring in everlasting righteousness, and to seal up the vision and prophecy, and to anoint the most holy. And verse number 25 says, know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the commandment to restore and to build Jerusalem unto the Messiah the Prince shall be 7 weeks, 62 weeks. The street shall be built again, and the walls, even in troublous times. So there is this commandment for the Jews to return to rebuild Jerusalem, to restore true worship. And we have discovered that there were three civil leaders that combined to fulfill this commandment to restore and to rebuild Jerusalem. Now hold your place in Daniel chapter 9. Let's turn to the book of Ezra. Ezra chapter 6. Go there with me. Ezra, the 6th chapter. And let's take a look at verse number 14 of Ezra chapter 6. The Bible says, and the elders of the Jews builded, and they prospered through the prophesying of Haggai the prophet and Zechariah the son of Iddo. And they builded and finished it according to the commandment of the God of Israel, and according to the commandment of Cyrus and Darius and Artaxerxes, king of Persia. Three kings that fulfilled chapter 9 of Daniel, verse 24 and verse number 25, this commandment to restore and to rebuild Jerusalem. And verse number 25 of the 9th chapter of Daniel tells us that this rebuilding, this restoration of Jerusalem would take place in troublous times. Now we discovered that when Cyrus gave that decree for the Jews to return to rebuild and to restore Jerusalem, that God's people were living in Babylon. Let's go to Ezra. Go back there. Ezra chapter 2. God's people, the Jews, they were dwelling in Babylon. And we are told in verse number 1 through verse number 2 that they were in Babylon when that call came for them to restore Jerusalem. And we saw in verse number 64 and verse number 65 that approximately 50,000 of the Jews left Babylon and went to restore and rebuild Jerusalem. And this approximate number of 50,000 people represent, and they were called the remnant, and they typify the remnant movement in these last days of Earth's history. Look at this statement, as I'm quoting from Prophets and Kings, page 598. Just for review, it says, honor the favor shown them by Cyrus, nearly 50,000 of the children of the captivity had taken advantage of the decree, permitting their return. These, however, in comparison with the hundreds of thousands scattered through other provinces of Medo-Persia, were but a mere remnant. The majority of the Israelites had chosen to remain in the land of their exile, rather than undergo the hardships of the return journey and the re-establishment of their desolated cities and homes. Now look with me at Ezra chapter 3. In Ezra chapter 3, as the remnant returned to restore and to rebuild Jerusalem, the Bible tells us that Satan began to work to weaken the hands of the builders. And Satan firstly began to work among the group called the remnant to weaken the hands of the builders. This can be verified in Ezra chapter 3, verse 11 through verse number 13. And the application is, among those who profess to be God's remnant people today, that among this group of individuals, Satan is going to work upon the minds of those who are not fully dedicated to God's end time work to murmur, to complain, to make unfavorable comparisons with this work, that ministry, this ministry, and the other, to weaken, to discourage, to weaken the hands of the true builders among the remnant people of God. That's why we are told in Selected Messages, Book 1, page 121 and 122, that we are far more to fear from within than from without. Then we saw in Ezra, the 4th chapter, that Satan not only worked from within the group that was called the remnant to weaken the hands of the master builders, but Satan worked from without. In Ezra chapter 4, we find these adversaries of Judah and Benjamin in verse number 1. And verse number 2 and verse 3, they professed to have been worshipers of the true and living God. And they came and they tried to unite with the remnant. And because they were pushed aside, they were told, "You have nothing to do with us in rebuilding and restoring Jerusalem." The Bible tells us in Ezra chapter 4, verse 1 through verse 23, that they petitioned the civil leader, the king in that time period, to weaken the hands of the remnant builders of Jerusalem. And they were to a great extent successful in weakening the hands of the workers of the remnant. Look at verse number 23. It says, Now when the copy of King Artaxerxes' letter was read before Rehum and Shimshai the scribe and their companions, they went up in haste to Jerusalem unto the Jews and made them to cease by force and power. This is not the true Artaxerxes. This was the imposter. And verse number 24 says, the work had ceased. Verse 24, then ceased the work of the house of God, which is at Jerusalem. So it ceased unto the second year of the reign of Darius, king of Persia. So when Cyrus gave that decree for the Jews to return and to restore Jerusalem, the Bible shows us that Satan worked from without, even from within, to bring a cessation to the restoring and the rebuilding of Jerusalem. But God then raised up another civil leader. His name was Darius. And Darius said it was time for God's people to rebuild, to restore Jerusalem. And the application is in the last days that Satan is going to work through professed Christians who will petition civil leaders and say, you must stop this group of people who are restoring spiritual Jerusalem. Their movement is a threat, a danger to both church and state. And Satan is going to work these ways to try to hinder God's end time movement. Look with me now in Ezra chapter 5. God's word says in verse number 2 and verse number 3 that Satan raised up a governor. His name was Tatnai. And the Bible says that he questioned the Jews who were restoring Jerusalem. And he asked them, who gave you this command to restore the house of Jerusalem and to build that wall? That's in verse number 3 of Ezra chapter 5. So right here we are seeing that a governor, Tatnai, who represents civil leaders in the last days, began to question and challenge the remnant people of God, who gave you this commandment to restore the house of Jerusalem as well as the walls of Jerusalem in the last days. Civil leaders are going to restrict our civil and religious freedom and declare we cannot restore spiritual Jerusalem. We cannot rebuild the walls of spiritual Jerusalem. And this governor represents a state official. State laws are going to be brought against God's remnant people in these closing scenes of this earth's history. Now notice, what would this also represent? The last time we were together, we looked at Luke chapter 20. And we saw in Ezra chapter 5, Satan worked through a civil leader. And the question was to God's people, who gave you the command, this commandment, to rebuild Jerusalem and its walls? Likewise, Satan worked among the Jewish leaders to question the authority of Jesus Christ to do gospel ministry. In Luke 20, verse 1 through verse number 8, the Bible says the Pharisees, the scribes, they came to Christ and asked him one question. Who gave you this authority? And who it is that gave you this authority to rebuild, to do this work? And of course, Christ asked them, I'll ask you one question. John the Baptist, who gave him his authority? So what was Christ doing? What was John the Baptist doing in John chapter 1, verse 29? John chapter 1, verse 19 rather. Verse 19 to verse number 26. What was John the Baptist and Christ doing when the Jews, the Pharisees, the scribes, the Sadducees, the chief priests began to question their authority of doing gospel ministry as it was then, so shall it be in the last days. As Christ begins to raise up true self-supporting ministries and churches and home churches and evangelists, those in the regular lines, those in apostasy who profess to be God's people are going to question and challenge the authority of God's true messengers. Who gave you the authority to establish this home church, this lighthouse in this city or in this rural district? Who gave you this authority? Who ordained you? Which school did you attend? Who laid hands on you to be able to be baptizing? To conduct the Lord's Supper, to hold revival meetings. Who gave you this authority to hold this medical missionary evangelistic effort? They are going to question and challenge the authority that God has given to his closing end time missionaries. Go back with me to Ezra chapter 5. Here we find Tatnai challenging God's people. And the Bible tells us when he began to do this, the Bible says now the words had reached the ears of Darius in Ezra chapter 6, verse number 1 through verse number 12. The Bible tells us when Darius heard that God's remnant people were being challenged, who gave you this authority to rebuild? The Bible tells us that Darius wrote and stated, I am strengthening the decree by Cyrus and also adding to it, you dare not stop the remnant from rebuilding Jerusalem and the walls of Jerusalem. Last time we discovered what Jerusalem, the house of Jerusalem, represents based on Ezra chapter 5 and verse number 3. And we saw the house of Jerusalem, number one, it represents our body temples for God's spirit to dwell. 1 Corinthians 6 verse 19 and verse 20. We also saw the house of Jerusalem that we must rebuild also represents lighthouses. It represents home churches. 1 Timothy chapter 3 and verse number 15. We also saw this house of Jerusalem also represent centers for evangelism. Zechariah chapter 8 and verse number 3. We are going to be challenged by churchmen and statesmen who are attempting to shut down the work of God. The walls of Jerusalem represent salvation. They point to God's Ten Commandments. Look with me, Ezra chapter 6, verse number 8. Go to verse number 7 of Ezra chapter 6. This is Darius speaking. Let the work of this house of God alone. Then verse 8, moreover, I make a decree. Skip on down, verse number 12. And the God that hath caused his name to dwell there, destroy all kings and people that shall put to their hand to alter and to destroy this house of God, which is at Jerusalem. I, Darius, have made a decree. Let it be done with speed. Notice, so God raised up Cyrus. Then came Darius, and he said, Jews, you now have freedom to rebuild and to restore Jerusalem, and now do it in haste. Do it speedily. Why? God's word tells us that God allowed them, God was commissioning them to build hastily. Why? Because the crisis in the days of Esther was fast approaching. And that crisis in the days of Esther was a crisis of the restriction of civil and religious liberty. Because Haman, in the book of Esther, chapter 3, wanted worship, reverence, homage, which should only be given to God. Look with me. Look at this statement here. I'm quoting from Prophets and Kings, page 598. It says, a score or more of years passed by when a second decree, quite as favorable as the first, was issued by Darius Histapes, the monarch then ruling. Thus did God, in his mercy, provide another opportunity for the Jews in the Medo-Persian realm to return to the land of their fathers. The Lord foresaw the troublous times that were to follow during the reign of Xerxes, the Hasuerus of the book of Esther. So what did God see coming? God saw a crisis as in the days of Esther. He saw it. It was coming. This was in the time period of Haman. The crisis, of course, with Mordecai. And of course, with Esther. Now look with me. Esther chapter 3, and this event with Haman, we are told it represents for us the mark of the beast crisis. It represents for us the national Sunday law. So God is telling us it's time for us to rebuild, to restore Jerusalem. Why? The crisis in the days of Haman, days of Esther, and Mordecai, this crisis is going to return very, very shortly. Our civil and religious freedom are going to be restricted from us. Look with me, Esther chapter 3, and look with me, verse number 2 through verse number 10. This is the crisis in the days of Esther. I want you to note this on your sermon note paper. Cyrus and Darius, they both represent offering to God's people civil and religious liberty. Amen. So when Haman came around, it was a restriction of civil and religious liberty. Now, what I want you to see is that for the application, Cyrus, who first gave that decree for the Jews to leave Babylon, to return, to restore, and to rebuild Jerusalem, offering them civil and religious freedom, Cyrus would represent for this closing end time movement of God, the United States of America, in the year 1776. Now look with me in your Bibles to Isaiah chapter 44. Go there with me. Isaiah chapter 44. Here's the point, my friends. Don't miss it. Here we have God called his people from Babylon. And they were to leave Babylon, and they were to go to restore the temple of where? The temple of Jerusalem. Amen. And who gave this decree for them to return and to restore Jerusalem the first time? It was the king Cyrus. And what we're seeing here is that this typifies the work of God's people in the year 1776, the work of the United States of America offering God's people and the world civil and religious freedom. Notice again, when Cyrus came on the scene, God's people were in Babylon, literally, physically, a call to restore the temple of Jerusalem. Notice, leading up to 1776, which power, which entity was ruling the world, and which entity had restricted civil and religious freedom from God's people? It was spiritual Babylon. And who was spiritual Babylon, my friends? This was the papacy. This was the papacy from what time period? 538 through 1798. And we are told that persecution had drawn to an end a quarter of a century before 1798. Back to the point. So now God began to call his people from spiritual Babylon, no longer being restricted based on civil and religious principles. He was now calling them to now, watch this, to restore not physical Jerusalem, but to restore spiritual Jerusalem. There it is, my friends. 1776, Cyrus, look with me. The Bible tells us in the book of Isaiah chapter 44. Look carefully. In Isaiah chapter 44, God's word show us in verse number 26 that before Cyrus was born, the Lord had already prophesied concerning the work of Cyrus. Verse number 26, that confirmeth the word of his servant and performeth the counsel of his messengers, that saith to Jerusalem, thou shalt be inhabited, and to the cities of Judah you shall be built, and I will raise up the decayed places thereof, that saith to the deep, be dry, and I will dry up thy rivers, that saith of Cyrus, he is my shepherd, and shall perform all my pleasure, even saying to Jerusalem, thou shalt be built, and to the temple thy foundation shall be laid. Isaiah 45, verse number 1, thus saith the Lord to his anointed, to Cyrus, whose right hand I have holden. Cyrus lived hundreds of years after Isaiah prophesied this on the inspiration. Look at this statement here. I'm quoting from Prophets and Kings, page 551. Inspiration says this: the advent of the army of Cyrus before the walls of Babylon was to the Jews a sign of their deliverance from captivity, that a sign of their deliverance from captivity was drawing nigh more than a century before the birth of Cyrus. Inspiration had mentioned him by name and had caused a record to be made of the actual work he should do in taking the city of Babylon unawares, and listen, and in preparing the way for the release of the children of the captivity. So now, hundreds of years before Cyrus was ever born, and did that work offering civil and religious freedom to God's people who were in Babylon to leave to restore the temple of Jerusalem. Likewise, God prophesied approximately 1700 years before the United States of America offered civil and religious freedom to the refugees, to the pilgrims, that's it, to those who were fleeing the old world from civil and religious persecution from the papacy. Now they could come to America and receive civil and religious freedom over 1700 years before. Look with me. The Bible tells us the 12th chapter of Revelation. Go there with me and look at verse 13. God's word says, and when the dragon saw that he was cast onto the earth, he persecuted the woman which brought forth the man child. And to the woman were given two wings of a great eagle. A woman represents the true church in this context, which brought forth, pardon me, and to the woman were given two wings of a great eagle, that she might fly into the wilderness, into a place where she's nourished for a time, and times, and half a time from the face of the serpent. And the serpent cast out of his mouth water as a flood after the woman, that he might cause her to be carried away of the flood. What time period is this? When the serpent is casting out of his mouth water as a flood to destroy the woman, destroy the church. It says time, times, half a time. Verse 6, same chapter, 12th chapter, Revelation. Verse 6 says, the time, the times, the half a time represent 1,260 prophetic days, 1,260 years. Who ruled the world for 1,260 years? It's the papacy from 538 AD to 1798 AD. This water in scripture represents people. Not only people now, but these flood were sent to destroy the church. It represents the enemies of God's people. Specifically, it represents the Jesuit order, the order of the Jesuits to counteract the Protestant Reformation. But verse number 16 says now, speaking about America, verse 16, and the earth helped the woman, and the earth opened her mouth and swallowed up the flood which the dragon cast out of his mouth. These are symbols. So the Bible tells us in verse 16, this earth opened its mouth and swallowed up the enemies of the church. Who is the earth a symbol of? Do we find the earth speaking anywhere else in scripture? Yes, chapter 13 of Revelation, Verse number 11 says, and I saw another beast as coming up out of the earth. Verse 11, he had two horns like a lamb, yet he spake as a dragon. This is America ascending, coming up out of the earth in 1776, offering in that time period these two horns, two powers, civil power and religious freedoms. This is the earth. Is that point clear? But verse number 17 now says, of the 12th chapter of Revelation, and the dragon was wroth with the woman and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. So where did the dragon go to make war? And the dragon was wroth with the woman and went to make war. Went where? To the earth. Because this is where the woman went. She was helped here, the United States of America. So the great crisis begins. The great crisis of the restriction of civil and religious freedom begins where the woman was helped by the earth, the United States of America. So now, this is Cyrus in 1776, the United States of America. Let's go back to our template. Cyrus says, you have civil and religious freedom to now leave Babylon to restore Jerusalem. In the time period of 1776, was there a movement preaching a message concerning the temple of the Lord? Yes. In the United States of America, there was a movement which began in 1798, to be specific. But let's be more specific. In the year 1831, this was William Miller and the Millerites. They began in this time period, the Millerites, they began in this time period to preach a message concerning the temple of the Lord. And what was the Millerites' primary scripture leading up to 1844? Their primary scripture was Daniel chapter 8 and verse number 14, which says what? Unto 2,300 days, then shall the sanctuary be cleansed. They were preaching a message concerning the temple of the Lord. Friends, it's interesting. In the time period of Cyrus, how many of the Jews left Babylon and returned to restore and to rebuild the temple of the Lord? How many returned? God's word says that they were approximately 50,000 people. Of course, they were Jews who left to return to restore Jerusalem. 50,000 under Cyrus. Watch the parallel. In the time period of 1776 through 1844, how many individuals had left Babylon and became more dedicated to the ministry and the movement of the Millerites in proclaiming the truth of Daniel 8:14, inspiration and a history record that there were approximately 50,000 individuals. Look at this statement from Great Controversy, page 376. It says this, watch carefully. As his work, William Miller, tended to build up the churches, it was for a time regarded with favor. Skip on down. The last two sentences. It says, those who sought to shut out the testimony of God's word, they could not regard as constituting the church of Christ, the pillar and ground of the truth. Hence, they felt themselves justified in separating from their former churches, their former brethren, their former connection. in the summer of 1844, about 50,000 withdrew from the churches. How many, my friends? About 50,000 withdrew from the churches, type and anti-type. Can you see that, my friends? 50,000 leading up to 1844. But notice, friends, let's go back to our time when Cyrus gave that decree for the Jews to return and to restore the temple of Jerusalem. 50,000, the remnant, they left Babylon and went to restore. But what happened that caused Jesus to raise up Darius? What happened? The Bible tells us the work of building and restoring Jerusalem had ceased. Hold your place in the book of Revelation. Go back with me to the book of Ezra. The work had ceased. Ezra chapter 4. Go back there with me. Ezra chapter 4. Look with me. Verse 24. Then ceased the work of the house of God, which is at Jerusalem. So it ceased unto the second year of the reign of Darius, king of Persia. So under Cyrus, the work had ceased. Later on, ceased. Likewise, when October 22nd, 1844 came around, what happened to the Millerites? Specifically, William Miller, they became discouraged. What happened October 22nd, 1844? It was the great disappointment, the great discouragement. The workers among the Millerites had stopped preaching, had stopped building, had stopped preaching the message concerning God's temple. Is that point clear? That was Cyrus. Let's go back. So now, who did God raise up after Cyrus? Who, friends? God raised up Darius to say what? It's time, Jews, to continue, rebuild, restore Jerusalem. That means after October 22nd, days after October 22nd, 1844, God must have a group of people typifying the work of Darius. Days after the great disappointment, God raised up the pioneers of the Seventh-day Adventist movement. And God gave them a message. And God's word to them was, it's time to continue to rebuild. It's time to continue to preach the message concerning God's temple, spiritual Jerusalem. And does the Bible say that Jerusalem is above? Yes, it says that. Close the book of Ezra. Let's go back. Now, look with me. The 10th chapter of the book of the Revelation. Go there with me. The Bible tells us the 10th chapter of Revelation and verse number 11. And most of you are familiar with this chapter. We have covered this before. Look at verse number 6. It says, and swear by him that liveth forever and ever, who created heaven and the things that therein are, and the earth and the things that therein are, and the sea and the things which are therein, that there should be time no longer. Which brings us to October 22nd, 1844. And verse number 11 now says, go back to verse number 10, and I took the little book out of the angel's hand and ate it up, and it was in my mouth sweet as honey, and as soon as I had eaten it, my belly was bitter. October 22nd, 1844, the great disappointment. However, verse number 11 now says, and he said unto me, thou must prophesy again before many peoples and nations and tongues and kings. Thou must prophesy again. It's time to rebuild. That means The movement under Darius represents the movement of the Seventh-day Adventist pioneers. Our movement since October 22nd, 1844. Follow me carefully. If you go back in your Bibles to Ezra chapter 6 and verse number 12, Darius said, Jews, it's time to build and build in haste. We read in Prophets and Kings, God wanted the Jews to build quickly because the crisis in the days of Haman, Esther, Mordecai was hastening. It was coming. So now, since October 22nd, 1844, God is telling us, thou must prophesy again. This is why God has given to us this name, prophesy again. It's time to prophesy again. It's time to restore spiritual Jerusalem. Number one, our body temples. Number two, our home church. Number three, establishing lighthouses. Establishing centers for evangelism. True gospel medical missionary evangelism. Oh yes, it's time to restore Jerusalem. Why? Because the crisis in the days of Esther with Haman and Mordecai, it's coming again in the form of the mark of the beast crisis right here. It's time for us to rebuild. It's time to restore. It's time to prophesy again. Look with me, Ezra. Look with me, Ezra. Go back there. Ezra chapter 6. You know, friends, as we're going back to Ezra chapter 6, you must also understand, not only did Isaiah prophesy concerning the crisis, the rebuilding in troublous times in the days of Ezra, Zerubbabel, and Joshua the high priest, but also Daniel spoke about this. And what I'm going to share with you touched my heart, not only because of what happened in history, but the application for us. Have you ever read the book of Daniel, where you see that Gabriel was in a battle with Satan for 21 days? Why do you think Satan was, why do you think Satan hindered Gabriel from speaking to Daniel and also doing, from speaking to Daniel, so much so that Michael, so much so that Jesus had to come and overthrow Satan again and release Gabriel for Gabriel to do the work he was sent to do? What was that controversy over? Number one, the controversy was that Satan did not want Gabriel to give Daniel the prophecy. Number two, that prophecy was regarding the Jews returning to restore and to rebuild Jerusalem. Let's take the second point. So the second point here is that Satan withheld God's people fighting with Gabriel for 21 days to hinder the work of restoring literal Jerusalem. So how would it be in the last days? As we are nearing home, Satan is going to work to hinder God's people from restoring spiritual Jerusalem. All right, look with me. Hold your place in the book of Ezra. Let's go back. Daniel chapter 10. Go there with me. Daniel chapter 10, and look with me at verse number 13. It says, but the prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 120 days. But lo, Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me, and I remained there with the kings of Persia. Look at this statement, Prophets and Kings. Page 571, it says, while Satan was striving to influence the highest powers in the kingdom of Medo-Persia to show disfavor to God's people, angels worked in behalf of the exiles. The controversy was one in which all heaven was interested. Through the prophet Daniel, we are given a glimpse of this mighty struggle between the forces of good and the forces of evil. For 3 weeks, Gabriel wrestled with the powers of darkness, seeking to counteract the influences at work on the mind of Cyrus. And before the contest closed, Christ himself came to Gabriel's aid, the prince of the kingdom of Persia, withstood me 21 days, 3 weeks. Gabriel declares, "But lo, Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me, and I remained there with the kings of Persia. All that heaven could do in behalf of the people of God was done." The victory was finally gained. The forces of the enemy were held in check all the days of Cyrus and all the days of his son Cambyses, who reigned about 7.5 years. This was a time of wonderful opportunity for the Jews. The highest agencies of heaven were working on the hearts of kings. And it was for the people of God to labor with the utmost activity to carry out the decree of Cyrus. And what was that decree? It's time to restore and rebuild Jerusalem. They should have spared no effort to restore the temple and its services and to reestablish themselves in their Judean homes. But in the day of God's power, many proved how? It says many proved unwilling. That's sad. Look with me. Close the book of Daniel. Hold your place in the book of Ezra. Let's turn now for the application in chapter 7 of Revelation. That statement in the book of Daniel and Prophets and Kings, page 571, it says that Satan for 21 days was trying to distort the power of God on the minds of kings. And the kings, Cyrus, Cambyses, they were allowing the Jews to get freedom, civil, religious, to restore and rebuild Jerusalem. For 21 days, Satan was trying to cause kings to restrict civil and religious liberty. What is the application? As God is telling us, it's time to restore and rebuild Jerusalem. Right now in America, we are civil and religious freedom. It is Jesus working on the minds of Supreme Court justices, congressmen, congresswomen, men in the Obama administration to allow God's people to still have civil and religious freedom, not only in America, Safe to Serve International, but in all of your countries. God is working on the minds of civil leaders, but Satan is also working. He's trying now to hasten these civil leaders to restrict our civil and religious liberties. As a result, God is telling us it's time to restore, it's time to rebuild spiritual Jerusalem, our bodies, our lives, our church homes, our home churches. It's time to establish centers of evangelism, lighthouses, train workers, training schools, medical, missionary, evangelism, to shed the light of truth to a world in darkness before Haman returns, before the deadly wound of the papacy is completely healed, before our civil and religious freedom are completely repudiated. It's time to restore. It's time to build. Are these points clear, my friends? Now, watch Chapter 7 of Revelation, verse 1 through verse 4. We know this. It is God who is saying to those four angels, hold the four winds of strife. That means nothing to you as yet until I give you this point. When you look in the book of Daniel chapter 7, verse 1 through verse number 4, those winds represent primarily nations. And who rule in nations? Kings, presidents, prime ministers, chancellors. So God is now working upon the minds of kings, civil leaders in nations. Hold the winds of strife until I seal four times. I seal the servants, my servants, in their foreheads. Don't allow the kings and churches to repudiate civil and religious freedom yet. Hold. And God is telling us it's time for us to pray the prayer. We must pray, dear God, hold the winds of strife. Go back with me. Ezra chapter 6. In Ezra chapter 6, we see, going back to our template, when the work began to cease, God raised up Darius. And he said, now, it's time. You have freedom. It's restored to you. Go back, rebuild and restore Jerusalem. Now, understand this point. God did not only look to a civil leader called Darius to encourage his people to restore and to rebuild Jerusalem, to flee from Babylon. But God raised up among his people two prophets. Do you know who they were? Ezra chapter 6 verse 14 tells us they were Haggai and Zechariah. Look with me. So now, who would Haggai and Zechariah represent today? Go with me. Ezra chapter 6. Let's take a look at the template here. Ezra chapter 6 verse 14. Haggai and Zechariah would represent for us the prophets, the chief leading prophet that God raised up after October 22nd, 1844, which was Ellen White. Look at the template again, friends. Don't miss this. The template. In the book of Ezra, Cyrus, then came Darius, then God raised up, watch carefully, God raised up Haggai. And of course, he raised up Zechariah. Now, this was under Darius. It's time to rebuild. Come down to the application. Between 1776 and October 22nd, 1844, the Millerites were preaching a message regarding God's temple, and they had ceased on the Great Disappointment Day, October 22nd, 1844, as God raised up Haggai. Then God must raise up a prophet. Oh, friends, do you see how we can prove that Ellen G. White was indeed on time? Indeed, the Lord's messenger. God must now raise up one like Haggai, and he did. He raised up Ellen G. White. And what was that message? It's time to rebuild. Ezra chapter 6, verse number 14. God's word says this. It says, and the elders of the Jews builded, and they prospered through the prophesying of Haggai the prophet and Zechariah the son of Iddo. Now in this study, for the next few moments, we are only going to focus on the message of Haggai to the remnant people under the decree by Darius. It's time to restore and rebuild because the crisis in the days of Esther is coming. So now we want to study the message from Ellen White that's telling us it's time to restore, it's time to rebuild spiritual Jerusalem while we now have civil and religious freedom. Why? The crisis as it was in the days of Esther, is coming again. The mark of the beast crisis. Go with me to the book of Haggai, chapter 1. In the book of Haggai, chapter 1, God's word says in verse number 1 of Haggai chapter 1, it says this: in the second year of Darius the king, in the sixth month, in the first day of the month, came the word of the Lord by Haggai the prophet unto Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, governor of Judah, and to Joshua, the son of Jozadak, the high priest, saying, thus speaketh the Lord of hosts, saying, this people say, the time is not come, the time that the Lord's house should be built. So what were the people saying when God raised up Darius? When God raised up Haggai to tell the people, it's time to rebuild, it's time to restore Jerusalem. What did the people say? What were they saying? They were saying, it's not time to build. It's not time to build and restore Jerusalem. That's serious. Number one, why? Who were the ones saying this? Who were the ones Darius was talking to? Who were the ones Haggai was talking to? These were not the majority of the Jews. They were talking to the remnant, the approximately 50,000 people who had left Babylon to return to Jerusalem to rebuild and restore. So now it was among the remnant people, the sentiment was, it's not time. It's not time. It's not time to restore and to rebuild Jerusalem. What is the application? Where were the rest of the Jews? They were still in Babylon, accepting the doctrines of Babylon, accepting and living the lifestyle of the Babylonians. They were not the ones saying verbally, it's not time to build. By their lifestyle, they were showing it was not time to build. The application is, the majority of Seventh-day Adventist Christians will not be making the effort to restore and to rebuild spiritual Jerusalem. And also among the group who profess to be present truth. Present, we are the remnant. We hold the present truth. Among them, individuals will rise up and say, it's not time to rebuild spiritual Jerusalem. It's not time to do evangelism for the world. Just preach among Seventh-day Adventists. It's not time. Look at this. Verse number 3 of Haggai chapter 1. Then came the word of the Lord by Haggai the prophet, saying, is it time for you, O ye, to dwell in your sealed houses, and this house lie waste? Now therefore, thus saith the Lord of hosts, consider your ways. So they were focused just on their own houses, but not on the outward house. Application. Today, many among present truth believers, they are focusing just on preaching the Seventh-day Adventists, but they are launching out aggressively to establish training schools for medical missionary evangelists, for youth evangelists. Understand this. Corporate evangelists. Understand this. Not establishing centers of evangelism to get the light to a dark world. They are satisfied with preaching only to Seventh-day Adventists because many of them say, well, probation closes on Seventh-day Adventists first. So only preach to Adventists now and wait until the mark of the beast crisis, the national Sunday law, then we can work aggressively for the world. That's an abomination in the sight of God. One great reason It's because people are dying every single day. Yet where are God's people just preaching among themselves? Yes. And saying, let's wait until the Son of the Law. Then we'll work aggressively. While souls in the church, souls in Babylon, souls in the world are dying every single day. And those who have the light have allowed that light to be placed under a bushel. That bushel represents the four walls of your church. Light is no good. Where other light is, put that light in darkness, and where was once darkness will then become light. Let me add one more thing before I deal more in depth on that point. It says in verse number 2, they were saying among the remnant, it is not time to build. One thing you must write down beside verse number 2 is that when they said it's not time to build, to restore Jerusalem, they were rejecting the words of the spirit of prophecy. Let's confirm that. God had told Jeremiah, the prophet, in the days of Nebuchadnezzar, to tell his people after 70 years, it's time, get ready to leave Babylon, leave captivity, and go and restore, rebuild Jerusalem. So when these Jews were saying, among the remnant now, it's not time, prophecy, it's not time, one more time, it's not time to restore Jerusalem, to rebuild Jerusalem, they were rejecting the words of the Spirit of God. Hold your place in the book of Haggai. So when preachers among Seventh-day Adventism, specifically among present truth circles, say, and by their actions, because some might not say it, but by their actions, they only work aggressively among the churches, but not for the world. They are rejecting the spirit of prophecy. It's time to build. Look at this. Hold your place in the book of Haggai. Let's go now to 2 Chronicles. 2 Chronicles chapter 36. Look with me at verse 19. In verse 19, it says, and they burned the house of God and break down the wall of Jerusalem. Verse number 21, it's verse 20. And them that had escaped from the sword carried he away to Babylon, where they were servants of him and his sons until the reign of the kingdom of Persia, to fulfill the word of the Lord by the mouth of Jeremiah, until the land had enjoyed her Sabbaths. For as long as she lay desolate, she kept Sabbath to fulfill 70 years. 70 years now, in the first year of Cyrus, king of Persia, that the word of the Lord spoken by the mouth of Jeremiah might be accomplished, the Lord stirred up the spirit of Cyrus, king of Persia. Verse 23, it's time to build God a house in Jerusalem, which is in Judah. It's time to build. Cyrus came, Darius came, and many among the remnant were saying, it's not time to build. And today, I'm going to share with you a statement I've heard over and over again, that many among present truth circles are saying, based on this statement, our focus primarily must be among Seventh-day Adventists and not for the world now. It's not time to go to the world right now. And there is a group among the 2520 contingent who are teaching this. It's not time to preach to the world. And friends, when you look at some of what they're preaching, no wonder they can't preach to the world, because even the world would not comprehend what they're saying, because many even among their group don't even comprehend what they're saying. And then we have the shepherd's rod, Branch Davidians. Their focus is primarily on Seventh-day Adventists, not primarily launching out to the world. And they love to quote this statement, some other groups. They quote, look at this statement. I'm quoting from Testimonies for the Church, Volume 6, page 370 and 371. It says, the Lord does not now work to bring many souls into the truth because of the church members who have never been converted and those who were once converted but who have backslidden. What influence would these unconsecrated members have on new converts? Would they not make of no effect the God-given message which His people are to bear? So now they say it's not time to preach to the world, even among those who profess to be preaching present truth. Do not go to the world yet. Just preach a Seventh-day Adventist. Yes, yes, friends, I've heard this for my own self. It's not time now to go to the world. But what says God's modern Haggai? The words of Ellen G. White, she puts it this way. Look at this statement. From Evangelism, page 59 says, to all people and nations and kindreds and tongues, the truth is to be proclaimed. The time has come for much aggressive work to be done in the cities and in all neglected unworked fields. So what time has come? This said the time has come for us now to go to the world. Look at this. It says often, page 33, often we have been told that our cities are to hear the message, but how slow we are to heed the instruction. I saw one standing on a high platform with arms extended. He turned and pointed in every direction, saying, a world perishing in ignorance of God's holy law and Seventh-day Adventists are asleep. The Lord is pleading for laborers, for there is a great work to be done. There are conversions to be made that will add to the church such as shall be saved. Men and women in the highways and byways are to be reached. We are far behind in following the light God has given regarding the working of our large cities. The time is coming when laws will be framed that will close doors now open to the message. Then she says, we need to arouse to earnest effort now while the angels of God are waiting to give their wonderful aid, assistance to all who will labor to arouse the consciences of men and women regarding what three things? Regarding righteousness, temperance, and judgment to come. It's time. And even though I have brethren out there, even among apocalypse and so on and so forth, they're all preaching that, listen, Jesus said we must only preach to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. And based on that statement in Matthew 10, our primary focus must solely be on Seventh-day Adventists. In the process, if we win a few people from the world, praise God. But our primary energies must be placed upon Seventh-day Adventists, because Christ says to his 12 disciples, only go to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. This is a deception. I love these brethren, but it is a deception. When we study God's word, it sounds like one, ignorance, or fear. Fear of the brethren. I'll come back to that point. Look with me. Matthew chapter 10. Hold your place in the book of Haggai. Go with me. Matthew chapter 10. Look at God's word in Matthew chapter 10 and verse number 6. God's word says, go to verse 5. Verse 5 says, these 12 Jesus sent forth and commanded them, saying, go not in the way of the Gentiles, and into any way of the Samaritans enter ye not, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. This sounds as if the lost sheep were only the Jews. Not so. A second application of the lost sheep was for those in the world, the Gentiles. Look at Matthew chapter 15. In Matthew chapter 15, verse number 21 through verse number 27, even Christ called the woman of Canaan from Tyre and Sidon. He called her a lost sheep of the house of Israel. Look at this statement for confirmation. This statement says, in The Desire of Ages, page 351, and put this quotation by Matthew chapter 10, verse 5 and verse 6. It says this, the disciples on their first missionary tour were to go only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. If they had now preached the gospel to the Gentiles or the Samaritans, they would have lost their influence with the Jews by exciting the prejudice of the Pharisees. They would have involved themselves in controversy, which would have discouraged them at the outset of their labors. Listen now, even the apostles were slow to understand that the gospel was to be carried to all nations until they themselves could grasp this truth. They were not prepared to labor for the Gentiles. So when Jesus says, don't go to the Gentiles, nor Samaritans, you 12 disciples, it was not a hindrance on the part of Christ, but they were not ready. It goes on to say, let's move on. Look at the statement, The Desire of Ages, page 400 says, they saw. This is Matthew 15 now. Verse 21 through verse 28. They saw that their master treated her with indifference. And they therefore supposed that the prejudice of the Jews against the Canaanites was pleasing to Jesus. But it was a pitying Savior to whom the woman made her plea. And in answer to the request of the disciples, Jesus said, I am not sent but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Although this answer appeared to be in accordance with the prejudice of the Jews, it was an implied rebuke to the disciples, which they afterward understood as reminding them of what he had often told them. Let's read now. That he came to the world. For what purpose, friends? To save all who would accept him. So my question is, who are the lost sheep of the house of Israel, both Jew and Gentile? The last sentence says, all who would accept Jesus is a lost sheep of the house of Israel. If the truth be told, this whole earth is represented in the parable of the lost sheep. 99 and one sheep strayed. That one sheep, the lost sheep, represents this earth and all who will accept Christ, Jew and Gentile, is being typified by the lost sheep. Look at this statement. One more statement. Let's take a look here at Acts chapter 8. It says, go to Acts chapter 8. I'm quoting now from Acts of the Apostles, page 105. It says, the persecution that came upon the church in Jerusalem resulted in giving a great impetus, great force and power and thrust to the work of the gospel. Success had attended the ministry of the word in that place, and there was danger that whom? The disciples would linger there too long, unmindful of the Savior's commission to go to all the world. Listen now, forgetting that strength to resist evil is best gained by aggressive service, they began to think that they had no work so important as that of shielding the church in Jerusalem from the attacks of the enemy. Instead of educating the new converts to carry the gospel to those who had not heard it, they were in danger of taking a course that would lead all to be satisfied with what had been accomplished. Then it says, to scatter his messengers abroad where they could work for others. God permitted what, friends? Persecution to come upon them. Driven from Jerusalem, the believers went everywhere preaching the word. Go to Acts chapter 8 with me. Acts chapter 8. So they were not to wait until Pentecost, Sunday law. Christ long before had wanted them to go to the Gentiles, the Samaritans, but they were unprepared. The 12, however, when Christ called the 70 disciples, where did Christ send those 70? He sent them to the Gentiles. That was Acts chapter 8, verse 1 through verse 4. But go with me now to Luke chapter 10. Go there with me. Luke chapter 10. Look with me. Luke 10. And this was before the cross. Oh, friend. And the crucifixion of Christ. Pilate's judgment hall. Who shall I give unto you? Christ or Barabbas? Who is your king? Who will you serve? That event typifies the Sunday law crisis. Sabbath or Sunday. And before Christ's crucifixion, which typifies the Sunday law crisis, where did Jesus send the 70 disciples? Where did Christ also desire to send the 12 disciples, but they were unready? To the Gentiles. Look with me. Luke chapter 10, verse 1, it's time to rebuild. After these things, the Lord appointed other 70 also and sent them two and two before his face into every city and place whither he himself would come. Where was this? Go back. I want to quote something for you from The Desire of Ages, page 488. Listen to this statement here. The Desire of Ages, page 488. It says this, paragraph 5, 1, 2, 3. It says, the directions, paragraph 4, the directions to the 70 were similar to those that had been given to the 12. But the command to the 12 not to enter into any city of the Gentiles or of the Samaritans was not given to the 70. Though Christ had just been repulsed by the Samaritans, his love toward them was unchanged. When the 70 went forth in his name, they went first of all to the cities of Samaria. Next paragraph says Christ himself went to Samaria. the leper who came back and thanked Jesus for healing was also a Samaritan. The woman at the well was a Samaritan. Even Christ was ministering to those in the Gentile world before his crucifixion. So what was Christ doing aggressively? He was sowing the seeds. Oh, friends. What was Christ doing? He was sowing the seeds. Go to Luke chapter 4 with me. And the point here, go to Luke 4, the point I'm making. We have to work just as aggressively for the world as we work for Seventh-day Adventists. We must sow the seeds in the world now. Why? Pentecost typifies the Sunday law crisis, the outpouring of the latter rain without measure in full power. Before Pentecost, who was sowing the gospel seed? Among the Jews and Gentiles, Christ and some of those disciples. What must be our work now? Luke chapter 4, verse number 42. It says this in verse 42. And when it was day, it says, he departed and went into a desert place, and the people sought him and came unto him and stayed him that he should not depart from them. Verse 43. And he said unto them, I must preach the kingdom of God to other cities also, for therefore am I sent. Let's pause right there. We are told in the book, The Great Controversy, page 612. In the time period of the Mark of the Beast crisis, many will separate themselves from spiritual Babylon, apostate family connection, because they received the message before the Sunday law crisis. They received our publications before the Sunday law crisis. So when must we now sow aggressively for the work? It is now. We are told in the book, Corporate Ministry, page 151. We are told that soon more than 1,000 will be converted in a day, many of whom will first point to their conviction of truth by the reading of our publications. Corporate Ministry, page 151. So when must we now sow the seeds aggressively among the world? I'm quoting from Evangelism, page 54 says, the precious truths that Christ had to proclaim were not to be confined to synagogues. No, Jesus labored in the way in which he desires his workers to labor today, by the sea, on the mountainside, in the streets of the city. His voice was heard explaining the Old Testament scriptures. That's how we must labor. On page 58, the book Evangelism, it says, the majesty of heaven journeyed from place to place on foot, teaching, out of doors, by the seaside, and in the mountain. Thus Jesus drew the people to him. Are we greater than our Lord? Was his way the right way? Have we been working unwisely in maintaining God's work? We have not learned our lesson yet as we should. Go back to Haggai. Haggai chapter 1. In Haggai chapter 1, God's word says, look with me, Haggai chapter 1, God's word says in verse 5 through verse number 11, as they began to build their own homes and did not return to restore and work aggressively to rebuild Jerusalem, the Bible says, as they sowed, they reaped little. as they builded, their buildings for their homes crumbled. As they earned monies and placed those monies in bags, it says, the bags had holes. They weren't prospering. Anti-type application. As we focus our attention for evangelism and so-called revival, week of prayers, just among Seventh-day Adventists, we may think that we are reviving the church. But my friends, in God's eyes, we are killing the church. We are causing Seventh-day Adventists to become gospel hardened. Look at this statement. I'm quoting from Evangelism, page 60. It says this: let us remember that as a people entrusted with sacred truth, we have been neglectful and positively unfaithful. The work has been confined to a few centers until the people in them have become gospel hardened. It is difficult to make an impression on those who have heard so much truth and yet have rejected it. In a few places, too much has been expended, while many, many cities have been left unwarned and unworked. It says, next paragraph, I want to quote this. Listen what this says here, friends. I'm quoting. It says this on page number 59. There are those, the book Evangelism, there are those who think it is their duty to preach the truth, but they dare not venture from the shore, and they catch no fish. They will choose to go among the churches over and over the same ground. They report a good time, a pleasant visit. But we look in vain for the souls that are converted to the truth through their instrumentality. These ministers hug the shore too closely. Let them launch out into the deep and cast their net where the fish are. There is no lack of work to be done. There could be hundreds employed in the vineyard of the Lord where there is now one. Go back to the book of Haggai. And this is one great danger among us. When our focus is only upon Seventh-day Adventists and not for the world, what happens is these preachers now begin to envy, grudge, and be jealous of other missionaries, other evangelists, other preachers. Why? They are striving for the attention of the same people among Seventh-day Adventists. Seventh-day Adventists number approximately 18 to 19 million people worldwide. How many people are in the world? Approximately 7 billion. There's much work for us. Haggai chapter 1, verse number 12. In verse 12 through verse 15, the Bible tells us Haggai told them, it's time to build, and they began to build. They caught the inspiration, the words of God from Haggai. Now we must catch the inspiration, the words of God from the Bible and the writings of Ellen G. White. I'm quoting the book Evangelism, page 61 says, oh, how I seem to hear the voice day and night saying, go forward, add new territory, enter new territory with the tent, and give the last message of warning to the world. There is no time to be lost. Leave my memorial again. Leave my memorial in every place where you shall go. Friends, what would God's memorial be? not only people, but leave centers of evangelism. Sister White says, when tents were pitched and will be pitched, she says, do not take down the tents and close the efforts too quickly until a place of worship is established. But friends, this means then we must establish home churches, establish centers of evangelism. But some preachers, even among present truth, because they do not want to be out of harmony with the so-called brethren, because they know to establish a self-supporting church, medical missionary center, not connected with the conference, may cut off their connection with the so-called brethren within the Seventh-day Adventist conference. As a result, they say, it is not time to build. It's not time to work aggressively for the world. Think about this. If we must work aggressively for the world, how then can we bring new converts among a backslidden leadership, not people, leadership among Seventh-day Adventism? Now, if the majority of the leaders are in apostasy, where are we going to bring the people? Did Jesus labor among the Gentiles? Did he convict and convert many, even a whole city? Christ won. Where did Christ lead them? Where? Friends, he allowed them to stay where they were. I believe most of his disciples, the 70, and the others ministered to them. John the Baptist, who baptized many people. Where did they attend church? John's disciples ministered to these people. When Pentecost came, many joined the true movement, even those who came from Matthew's home church. It's time to rebuild. It's time to restore. And let me say this. Watch this. While some within the circles of present truth are saying, it's not time to build. It's not time to do evangelism. Just focus mainly upon Seventh-day Adventists. The majority, or let me say the rest of Seventh-day Adventism, those who are in apostasy, most of them are doing evangelism. But they are fulfilling the words of Matthew 23, verse number 15. Where Jesus says, woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites. You compass sea and land to make one proselyte. But when he's made, you make him twofold, the child of hell, the child of the devil, than yourselves. Go to Micah. So we have to make sure that we are building correctly and restoring true spiritual Jerusalem. Micah, go there with me. The book of Micah. Micah chapter 3. Look with me. Micah chapter 3 and verse number 9. God's word says it this way. Hear this, I pray you, you heads of the house of Jacob and the princes of the house of Israel that abhor judgment and pervert all equity. They build up Zion with blood and Jerusalem with iniquity. So were they building Zion? But how? They were building Jerusalem with blood and iniquity. Verse 11, who were they? Verse 11, the heads, the leaders thereof, judge. They preach for reward, for money, for a paycheck, for a retirement check, for a name on a certificate on some wall, the Hall of Fame within Seventh-day Adventism. I want to be, many say, the next C.D. Brooks, to have my name inscribed on something, the next E.E. Cleveland, the next Joe Cruz. Sad friends, It says, the heads thereof judge for reward, and the priests thereof teach for hire, and the prophets thereof divine for money. Yet will they lean upon the Lord and say, is not the Lord among us? None evil can come upon us. Verse 12, therefore shall Zion for your sake be plowed as a field, and Jerusalem shall become heaps. However, Micah chapter 4, verse number 1 says, but in the last days it shall come to pass, the mountain of the house of the Lord shall be established. Verse 2, and many nations shall come and say, come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord and to the house of the God of Jacob, and he will teach us his ways, and we will walk in his paths. For the law shall go forth of Zion, and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. So while many are restoring, rebuilding Jerusalem with blood and iniquity, God is going to have a group of people that will restore true spiritual Jerusalem. Yes, look with me. Is God building up Jerusalem? Go to Psalm 147. Hold your place in the book of Haggai. Go to Psalm 147. Psalm 147, verse number 2. God's word says, the Lord, is it not time to build? Yes. Or a body temple, or a home churches, centers for evangelism, for both Seventh-day Adventists and the world. Verse 2, the Lord doth build up Jerusalem. He gathereth together the outcasts of Israel. So now, is God building up Jerusalem? Yes. Who will entail? Who will make up Jerusalem? It says, he gathers together the outcasts of Israel. In type, who were the outcasts of Israel? These were the Gentiles who would turn to him. The leper who turned to him. The Samaritan woman who turned to him. The centurion who turned to him. The Lord doth build up Jerusalem and gathers together the outcasts. So who would they represent? They would represent those who are coming from Babylon into God's present truth, God's everlasting gospel. God doth build up Jerusalem and gathereth together the outcasts of Israel. The outcasts, not only do they represent those from Babylon coming into God's everlasting gospel, but God's commandment-keeping people will also be called outcast. Close Psalm 147. Hold the book of Haggai. Go with me in your Bibles now to the book of Isaiah chapter 66. Go there with me. Isaiah chapter 66. Inspiration says, Sister White penned in the book Testimonies for the Church, volume 1, the chapter entitled Leaving the Methodist Church. When her and her family members were excommunicated from the church, disfellowshipped, barred from the church because they stood for God's truth, she says, this was the scripture that encouraged them. Isaiah 66, and those who stand for present truth, the everlasting gospel, Save to Serve International, when we stand for God's truth, even those among Seventh-day Adventists will begin to bar us. They will marginalize us. They will even disfellowship us, excommunicate us. Why? Because we're standing upon God's sure rock of truth, the everlasting gospel. Isaiah 66, verse 5, it says this, hear the word of the Lord, and you that tremble at his word, your brethren that hates you, that cast you out, outcast, that cast you out for my name's sake, said, let the Lord be glorified, but he shall appear to your joy, and they shall be ashamed. Note this, quotation from Fundamentals of Christian Education, page 287 and 289. We are told, when God's people reach the standard that God would have them to reach, worldlings will call true Seventh-day Adventists odd, singular, straight-laced, extremist. Fundamentals of Christian Education, page 589. Yes, we are going to be called outcasts. But praise God, Jesus was also called an outcast. Where was Christ crucified? God's word says that Jesus was crucified. He was placed outside of the gate. He was called an outcast. Oh, yes. But the Bible says in Psalm 147, the Lord doth build up Jerusalem and gather together the outcast of Israel. Go back with me. Haggai. Let's bring this to a close. Haggai chapter 1. Go there with me. Go to Haggai chapter 2. In Haggai chapter 2, God now says through Haggai to his people, in verse number 3, he says this, who is left among you that saw this house in her first glory? And how do you see it now? Is it not in your eyes in comparison of it as nothing? Yet now be strong. And be strong, all you people of the land, and work, for I am with you. They were not to make unfavorable comparisons with the first temple and the second temple, but it is going on now. I want to quote this for you. The book Evangelism, page 371, says, the ministers of Christ should take their position and not be hindered in their work by these agents of Satan. There will be enough of these to question and quibble and criticize to keep God's ministers constantly busy. If they will allow themselves to be detained from the great work of giving the last saving message of warning to the world. If the church has no strength to stand against the unsanctified, rebellious feelings of church grumblers, it is better to let church and grumblers go overboard together than lose the opportunity of saving hundreds who would make better church members and have the element existing within themselves of strength and union and power. The very best way for ministers and churches is to let this fault-finding, crooked class fall back into their own element and pull away from the shore, launch out into the deep, and cast out the gospel net again for fish that may pay for the labor bestowed upon them. Satan exhorts when men and women embrace the truth who are naturally fault-finding and who will throw all the darkness and hindrance they can against the advancement of the work of God. Ministers cannot now, in this important period of the work, be detained to prop up men and women who see and have felt once the force of the truth. They should fasten believing Christians on Christ who is able to hold them up and preserve them blameless until Christ appearing, while they go forth to new fields of labor. Let's close, friends. I am finished. Go with me. Psalm 51. It's time to rebuild. Throw those church grumblers overboard. They are here to weaken our hands. Unfavorable comparison. They are here to shut down the work. Don't prop them up. Don't give them time. Launch out in the deep. It's time to rebuild. Look with me. Psalm 51, we close. Look at verse 10. David now speaks of the spiritual temple that must be restored. Then we can establish more fully our home churches and centers for aggressive evangelism. Verse 10, David pens. He prays. He says, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and uphold me with thy free spirit. Then will I teach transgressors thy ways, and sinners shall be converted unto thee. Do you see the outflowing of restoring spiritual Jerusalem? Then it says, skip on down to verse number 16. For thou desirest not sacrifice, else I would give it. Thou delightest not in burnt offering. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart, O God, thou wilt not despise. Verse 18, do good in thy good pleasure unto Zion. Build thou the walls of Jerusalem. Praise God, friends. So when we encounter and have the experience, like David in Psalm 10, we are building the individual spiritual temple. And then it is Christ now who sends us forward now. Verse 18, do good in thy good pleasure unto Zion, build thou the walls of Jerusalem. Verse 19, then shalt thou be pleased with the sacrifices of righteousness, with the burnt offering and a whole burnt offering. Then shall they offer bullocks upon thine altar. Then Jesus will accept our sacrifices. And as the fire descended to accept Solomon's sacrifices on the altar, once he built the literal temple, so we can be, listen, we can be agents to receive the outpouring of the Pentecostal shower. Listen, Testimonies for the Church, volume 8, page 297 says, the Lord calls for a revival of the straight testimony. Born in past years, he calls for a renewal of the spiritual life. The spiritual energies of his people have long been torpid. And there must be a resurrection from apparent death. By prayer and confession of sin, we must clear the King's highway. And as we do this, the Spirit of God will come to us. We need the Pentecostal energy. This will come, for the Lord has promised to send his Spirit, the all-conquering power. That's it, my friends. How do you feel right now? This must be our experience. Father in heaven, we thank you for these few moments spent in your word. Keep us faithful, dear God. It's time to rebuild. It's time to restore spiritual Jerusalem. You will help us as we pray, as we confess, and we clear the King's highway. Send us forward and save us, we pray. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. Amen. Okay, friends.